dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen. Baltimore has been hit by a cyber attack. $18 million is what's the current cost that Baltimore is experiencing just for getting back on rails. And that's not enough. The fact remains is that when we talk of cybersecurity, it's a different ballgame altogether. I'm more interested with this particular robo of the Chinese news agency, which has been now launched in November. It's the world's first artificial intelligence robo, which is reading news, which is analyzing news simultaneously and giving you perspectives. And if this kind of a robo, while on live news, tends to get hacked and tends to be misused, see the potential ramifications that could exist. This survey tells us that the human intelligence will be crossed by artificial intelligence by 2062. I believe those figures are wrong. The actual tipping point is going to come much earlier. No wonder artificial intelligence today, apart from being an opportunity, is one of the biggest challenges for cybersecurity. Because on the dark net, you have abilities to actually start using AI services for breaching cybersecurity. And of course, various applications are there. The school in the US is now using AI for detecting whether children are carrying guns or not. So if AI gets to be using for cybersecurity breaches, see the ramifications and the problems that we have. Already today, lack of attribution is a big challenge. I can't find out who's hitting my networks, whether it's a state or a non-state actor. What's the real identity? With VPNs and the darknet being the de facto mode, clearly we have a big challenge at hand. So when this headline tells you that you actually do not know what you are doing is artificial intelligence, it's perfectly bang on target. And when we are doing this particular conclave on cybersecurity, India conclave, I thought, let me share with you certain nuances that I can see on the horizon, which could potentially impact the way how legal jurisprudence is likely to evolve. The first big problem is, how do we even give legality to AI? Can we make AI as a legal person? Can we say artificial intelligence has an actus reus, a mens rea, an intention to commit a crime? Can we make the coders responsible? And can we send them behind bars? Can we come up with legal principles to try to enable and regulate artificial intelligence at the same time? Clearly, those are big challenges. We have created the Artificial Intelligence Law Hub, where we are looking at global legal principles on how to regulate, enable artificial intelligence. So I think this will be a big priority in terms of regulation as we go forward on the cybersecurity ecosystem as a whole. When I look at this particular slide, this tells me that the global cost of cybercrime would exceed $6 trillion by 2021. And I believe those figures are wrong. Your actual cost is going to be far, far more than just $16 trillion. Another figure tells us that by the end of 2019, the cost, global cost of cybersecurity breaches should exceed more than $2 trillion. So cyber attacks are galore, wherever you look at, whatever sector, whatever vertical, it's all happening. I just don't want to acknowledge it, is a different matter altogether. But the fact is, everybody is getting hacked in terms of money, in terms of cryptocurrencies, in terms of data, and the like. Everything, even the defense contractors are getting impacted. So there's nothing called absolute security. So once there is nothing called absolute security, how do we deal with the legalities concerning artificial intelligence per se? Bangladesh's big bank got attacked, $86 million US dollars taken off. And now they are suing a bank in the Manila in Philippines because they have been able to track it down. And mind you, where is the lawsuit being filed? Not in Bangladesh, not in Philippines, but in the United States of America, where this particular Philippines bank has got assets per se. Electronium, the British cryptocurrency, collected £30 million and they got hacked and the entire money went for a six. Equifax, the United States' biggest cybersecurity breach, $140 million credit card, debit card details stolen. Still no clue as to how things have happened. Well, when media says India is losing its cybersecurity war, I'm not surprised. In fact, as a nation, we haven't even begun. We are till now only giving lip service to cybersecurity. Yes, we came up with the national policy on cybersecurity in the year 2013. But 2013 to 2019, we've just seen the policy remain a mere paper tiger. We have not been able to implement it. We don't have a dedicated law on cybersecurity per se. Companies in India continue to keep on losing money. MobiQuick lost 19 crores and still counting. Ransomware, botnets, and distributed denial of service attacks are the de facto norm. WannaCry hit the Jawaharlal Nehru port. It hit so many corporates, except it didn't get reported. 150 countries impacted. The actual loss still not calculated. South Korea is already right now in an emergency mode. Why? Because all the banks and all the lending institutions in South Korea have been threatened that they better well pay ransom in advance. Otherwise, they will be attacked with ransomware. That's the new paradigm that's happening. So they're trying to find out how could they proceed forward. Nobody is secure, not even a Supreme Court judge. Justice Madan Lokur, while sitting in the Supreme Court, found that his own email got hacked. He reported. Until today, we have not been able to find out who actually did it. So you have to understand your position in society is no guarantee that you will always have the right answers on who has hacked your respective systems or not. So when I look at cybersecurity, I find the world is moving very, very quickly. Countries are coming up with very strong laws on cybersecurity. The Chinese cybersecurity law has been a precursor of sorts. In fact, China has been in overactivity mode. 3 years, three national legislations on cybersecurity. And I think these have been the most comprehensive legislations on cybersecurity that we've seen. No wonder. In the last few years, a new discipline of law has emerged. This is known as cybersecurity law, which is basically looking at the legal, policy, and regulatory issues pertaining to cybersecurity, its protection, preservation, and continued updation and maintenance. Okay, let's get some fundamental things clear. First, at the international level, there is no international cyber law in place. No international cybersecurity law in place. So what do? Do we want countries to keep on waiting? Well, they're not waiting. Yes, there's the Convention on Cybercrime of the Council of Europe, but that's only a cybercrime convention. 60 nations have only subscribed to the convention. India has still not signed the Budapest Convention. So in a scenario like this, when there's lack of an international treaty, countries do not know how do they want to go forward. So what they're doing is, they're now saying, let me not wait for the international legal frameworks to come in place. Let's now come up with their own bilateral arrangements. There's a vacuum for international policy and treaty. I've been talking, and this is from 2015, about the need for an international convention on cyber law and cyber security. Of course, countries are still slow because countries are doing both covert and overt activities. And they may not want themselves to be completely regulated by this kind of scenarios. So they are saying, let me look at it at two different levels. Number one, let me come up with my own national laws. Number two, let me come up with bilateral arrangements so that I can share more information with other countries on a bilateral basis per se. So leading the pack is China. China has first come out in 2016 with a law known as their national security law. They only said one thing in that law. My cybersecurity is a part of my national security, period. They followed it up with a dedicated cybersecurity law, which is one of the most comprehensive laws. And come last January, they came up with internet mitigation measures. That's a third kind of a cybersecurity regulation. But what do they say? They have come up with the concept of cyber sovereignty. They say my sovereignty in China, or cyber sovereignty of China, extends not just to the territorial boundaries of China, it extends to outer space, to deep sea beds, to the Arctic and Antarctic. That's the way they are actually now going ahead and drafting their laws. So clearly, they're not bothered about how they will implement it, but there are challenges. Vietnam last year has come up with a new cybersecurity law. This law has come up with a very remarkable concept of a national cyberspace. I thought cyberspace was a global paradigm, but they say, look, the entire internet is my national cyberspace, and my laws will be applicable to all the internet per se. Bilateral arrangements are coming up, and countries are very, very feverishly talking to each other about these cooperation agreements, but they're only a very, very small step in the right direction. Why? International problems like cybersecurity cannot be dealt with bilateral approaches. So we are now coming back again to national strategies. In India, our only focus till now remains at the National Cybersecurity Policy of 2013. So some things are very, very clear. And now with the Modi 2.0 government coming back, it's crystal clear that the topmost priority of this government has to be that it must come up with a dedicated cybersecurity law. Why? Because we need to protect not just the Indian nation, Indian data sovereignty, but also the critical information infrastructure of India. And that could potentially be building up on the basis of the National Cybersecurity Policy of 2013. Of course, there's a need for beefing up of the Information Technology Act and coming up with appropriate supplemental legislations as well. Policy on cybersecurity is important, but I think mere policy is not good enough. You will need to come up with effective updation mechanisms and constantly implementing the same so that you could effectively present your thought leadership to the world at large. And I think as we go forward, we have a challenge. How do we maintain a balance between protecting of Indian national interests on the one hand, and also ensuring that the protection of privacy and data protection on the other? Already, India has now a proposed Personal Data Protection Bill 2018, which we hopefully should be passed this year. It'll be interesting to see what kind of a golden balance does India go forward. Of course, we have challenges. Aadhaar data is being thrown all across. It's actually being shared at various levels, and we've seen so many cases. Well, the UIDAI alone lodged more than 50 FIRs for breaches of Aadhaar data. So we have a big challenge and a problem at hand of how to deal with the leakage of Aadhaar information in the hands of people who are not authorized to do it. Good thing about the Indian government, in 2017, in January, they came up with a notification. This is the 4th January notification of the Computer Emergency Response Team, which said that if you are a company, if you are a body corporate, or if you are a data center in India, and you find that you are a victim of a cybersecurity breach, and these are one of the 10 cybersecurity breaches that are stipulated, you must report it. You do not report it, it actually becomes an offense. So India paved the way for data reporting, cybersecurity reporting mechanisms. Of course, we have not been seeing much implementation. Most of the companies don't want to report because this might be seeing them in a wrong light. But these are mandatory requirements, and I think countries and companies need to quickly realize that they better well comply with existing law or they are going to have problems. Aadhaar is another complete big set on which we'll have to do a lot of homework on cybersecurity. Unfortunately, when I look at the Aadhaar Act and the rules and regulations under the Aadhaar Act, I find the kind of focus that should have been there on cybersecurity is missing. I think we must now start beefing that up. Gone are the days we can say, look, let us close our eyes and Aadhaar will go off. No, Aadhaar is the ground reality. So the scenario right now is, how best can we strengthen the hands of the Indian government and the Indian ecosystem, as also the Aadhaar users, so that our data is reasonably secured from all kinds of unauthorized accesses. So I think, ladies and gentlemen, the fact now remains, if you are using any of the 7 raw materials that are available today, if you use computers, computer systems, computer networks, computer resources, communication devices, as also data and information in the electronic form, you are covered under the Indian cyber law. And you better well know that. One of the special laws in India, according to me, one of the 3 most significant legislations in Indian history. Why? Anything to do with electronic format, the IT Act is your only law. Number 2, the IT Act is a special law. It prevails over anything inconsistent therewith contained in any other law for the time being in force. So it's not a cybersecurity law. It's only a law for promoting e-commerce. Though in 2008, in the amendments, we did come up with a definition of what constitutes cybersecurity. However, we did not come up with detailed provisions, only cosmetic provisions impacting cybersecurity per se. We actually even made the Computer Emergency Response Team as India's nodal agency on cybersecurity. I think a lot of work needs to be done on these data intermediaries under the proposed Personal Data Protection Bill. We call them data fiduciaries. IT Act comes up with the concept of an intermediary. Any person who on behalf of another person receives, stores, or transmits that record, or provides any service with respect to electronic records, is effectively an intermediary. Telecom service providers, internet service providers, web hosting companies, online auction portals, online payment sites, cyber cafes, search engines, and online marketplaces. Everybody is an intermediary. How many of you are not on WhatsApp? Please raise your hands. No hands. Everybody is on WhatsApp. Excellent. So the session later today to show how your WhatsApp can be hacked should be an eye-opener for all of us. So when we are all on WhatsApp, and all of you are there, how many of you have read the terms and conditions of WhatsApp? Again, no hands. One. So Rohit has read it because that's his main passion. But barring him, nobody else has read it. If you would read it, you may potentially never use WhatsApp because it says, whatever I publish on WhatsApp, audio, video, image, text, is public information. You have no privacy. And consequently, your information is already now being shared by WhatsApp with Facebook and Facebook group of companies since September 2016. So it's time that you should start migrating onto other platforms like Signal and Telegram rather than just being stuck up with WhatsApp because your peer group is using WhatsApp. And I think WhatsApp has a huge number of skeletons already up in place. So the thumb rule is, if you're using the electronic format, please comply with the Indian Information Technology Act because it's granted legality to the electronic records. It provides the legal basis for all your electronic transactions. It has actually legalized the electronic format. And more significantly, it also provides you with effective remedies in the event you get attacked. Of course, electronic governance is a big focus area, and enabling legal frameworks for promoting electronic governance has been an integral part of this particular legislation. This is not a cybercrime law, but in 2000, the Parliamentary Select Committee said, look, put us a chapter on cybercrimes. So we got a new chapter, Chapter Roman 11, under the IT Act, where a variety of cybercrimes got to be elaborated. Those days, life was good, because a majority of cybercrimes were non-bailable offenses. Come 2008, after the Mumbai attacks, and the amendments actually watered down the law. It actually said, barring 3-4 cybercrimes, every cybercrime in India is a bailable offense. You commit the cybercrime, get a bail as a matter of right, and then walk away to glory. No wonder, India has seen a famine of cybercrime convictions from 2009 till 2019 per se. I think this entire law pertaining to intermediaries need to have a completely new twist. Why? Because when we introduced this concept in 2008, life was different. Today, intermediaries are far more powerful than even your local governments or even some of the ministries in the government. So in a scenario like this, it's important that they must be subject to reasonable control within the local legislation. Now that's not happening. A majority of these foreign companies say, sir, I'm an American company governed by American laws. You get me a court order from America and I will comply. They're not willing to comply with Indian law. And I think that's a problem. There's been lack of political will. If a country of 1.3 billion decides that if you have to do business in India, you better will comply, otherwise leave India, I think the message would be very, very clear. China gave the same message to the Googles of the world. Of course, Google chose not to work in China, and they have now lost a big territory. I think no company in its sanity would like to lose India as such a huge e-commerce opportunity. And therefore, compliance with local laws is only a very small component of this entire stuff. I think the good news is that the intermediaries are mandated to exercise due diligence. The bad news is that a lot of parameters of due diligence have not been defined under the law so far. The last time we defined due diligence was only in 2011. 8 years down the line, a lot of new developments have already taken place. This is some of the work that we'll end up doing. So I'm very, very clear on certain key closing thoughts as we go forward, which is to say that the time is out. And my time out, as I say, I can only conclude by saying cybersecurity is an important concept. We need to give appropriate attention to it. We've been doing this conference every year, the International Conference on Cyber Law, Cyber Crime, Cyber Security, where we're trying to push the jurisprudence. And I believe the next 2-3 years are going to be critical. So hopefully, contributions of conferences like these will start working in the direction. And finally, let's take home one final message. Whatever be the law of the land, please comply with the same. Even if it's deficient, no problem. I think the law needs to be beefed up. The government will be beefing it up. But as we come across with new legal frameworks, we must take all efforts possible to ensure compliance with existing law and also ensure that the law needs to be constantly updated, keeping in mind these new emerging technologies like artificial intelligence, blockchains, and Internet of Things. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It's lovely talking to you.